green as possible. That's greener. It's not in the titles, but nobody will remember anyway. I will talk about naming things, naming essentially variables, classes, modules, constructs in your code. So the advice I'm going to give applies at all levels, starting from variables all the way to like services and applications. And I'm giving it based on what I've read, books, articles, based on what I've encountered with various projects. I have worked well in front end and in back end, and a little bit data science, and a little bit batch integrations and so on. So various sorts of domains, banking, financial services, what else? Advertisement, public events, and so on. So I'm mostly a JVM developer. So I work with Java, Scala, Ruby, Clojure. Not Kotlin yet, but I would like to try it. In the front end, JavaScript, of course, ClojureScript, and then PHP, C Sharp, even Visual Basic, but don't tell anyone. So, what I've gathered through all these years and books and so on, I'll try to condense in 40 minutes or so. This is a programming language. Do you know what it's called?
Okay.
Yeah, it's called OOC. Please remember. It's a programming language friendly to orangutans. So orangutan-friendly programming language. Because that's the three sounds they can express. It's OOC, OOC, and OOC. And so, turns out, it's all you need. Only three-bit, a triple-bit, bit all you need to express any kind of Turing-complete problem. So it is Turing-complete. The way they do it is they assign special meaning to sequences of OOC sounds. So, I don't remember exactly, but OOC followed by OOC means move pointer to the right. Then two OOCs consequently means increment the number at the pointer by one. So it's literally a Turing machine. There's the needle, it goes left or right, and you can do stuff with numbers at once. And so you can do anything with it. And that's a hello world program. Really. The thing about OOC is that it does not have what we call means of abstraction. So it has means of composition, okay, so we can compose primitives together, but no means of abstraction. There's another language like that, or used to be, the assembly language. So this is the oldest assembly I could find. Maybe you can find an older one. It's called EDSAC. EDSAC stands for, sorry, it's not there for some reason. It stands for something you don't remember. Matter. It has no means of abstraction as well. So all it has is primitives and means of composing them together. So you don't have to think about names at all when you program. This is also Hello World. It's a program which prints Hello World out to console. Punch cards, maybe, not console, some printer out. So yeah, for a while it was all cool. This language was like 1949 maybe. Pretty old, but then they spoiled it. So they created an assembler which actually had means of abstraction, so you could assign labels to statements. So here you only have statements, right? And here you can say, okay, I have statements, but I'm allowed to assign labels to them. And when I do that, I'm allowed to jump to labels. So when I jump, I say where exactly I'm jumping, right? Which gives meaning to things. But then, you know, it was so easy, you didn't have to think about names at all. And now, you have another problem. Not only do you have to think about algorithms, but also how to name stuff. And that's pretty hard. And it's also misleading, quite often. The first time I saw this algorithm, I thought it's some kind of metric unit converter. So you have inch, right? So you convert inches to something. have jump to ouch, which is like exception handle, I guess. Jump to ouch, I don't know. Of course, that's not what they mean. Binge means input char, and ouch means the output char. So you have a problem. Sometimes words have consequences, what it doesn't mean, which is only a problem if you have names in your program. Nowadays, it's always the case. So let's go through some of the advice which can help you be a better namer. Naming is so important, and I'll talk about why. And it's actually the second rule in the Ken text for rules of simple design. So you may or may not have read them, but they are pretty simple. So your design is simple if it passes all the tests, so it has tests by implication. It's well named. And it doesn't say it's well named, it says it's clear, expressive, and consistent. So that's what well named means. It's dry, so no duplication, and it's minimal. So if you're doing test-driven development, you kind of get all of these by default. So you have minimal implementation, which is well named if you don't forget refactor, and also no duplication if you don't forget refactor, and you have tests for everything. Okay. Phil Cartman once famously said that there are only two hard things in computer science, that's cache validation and naming things. I wasn't clear how serious he was about the first item, but now I'm pretty sure he was pretty serious. But naming things is also pretty hard. And some of the advice you can apply starts from very simple things like how long should the name be. And it sounds abstract, but I'm talking about abstract things, so bear with me. So how long should a name be? Like in Java, the shortest class name in Java is URL, shortest class name in .NET is SR, and PHP is DL. Any PHP coders around here? Former PHP coders? Yay! Don't be shy. Yeah, so what does DL mean in PHP?
Link something?
No? Anyone?
Dynamic library? No?
Yeah. I think it's called dynamic load or dynamic link or something like that. But it's not clear from the name, right? So there was a very good article by a German guy who has two PhDs, one PhD in psychology and another PhD in computer science. It's a very interesting combination of skills. And so wrote an article which explained his study. He did actually a study with hundreds of developers, asking them to look at a piece of code and find a bug in it. And he had three versions of the same code, one with long, clear names, one same algorithm, but only one letter names, and the middle one, same algorithm, but only abbreviations. So like CST for customer, for example. And he measured how long it takes for them to find a bug in each of the cases. And of course, no surprise, when they use one letter names, it takes about twice as long as when you use full names, long names. So it would seem that long names are always better, but of course it depends. So in Java, for example, URL is a perfectly valid name because we all know what it does. If we were to call it Uniform Resource Locator, it wouldn't make it any better. Probably make it worse. About long names, how long can it get? Well, in Java it can get pretty long. In .NET actually it's one letter longer. I was able to find these class names. In PHP not so bad, I guess. Well, at least bad names. What do you think, at least bad names or good names?
Not great.
Not great. Yeah, well, you could say they could be shorter, but then if you look at them, they kind of put everything on the table, right? So I'm member submission everything WSDL parser extension. So I extend the WSDL parser by submitting member everything or something like that. But you know, it's pretty clear what this class does if you know WSDL and addressing and so on from the name. So I'm not against sometimes long names. They could be a little bit shorter, but you know, I'd rather have names like these rather than DL and SR. By the way, what SR means, I still have no idea. I was a .NET developer. No idea. Right, so what's clean code according to Ward Cunningham is on each routine you write is pretty much what you would expect. So when you see a function or a class or method, you see its name and signature, parameters, output, right, maybe. And by that you can deduce what this method probably is doing, right? Then you go ahead and look into its implementation, and it's about right. So it's about what you expect. When you have that, it means you have well-named code and well-named structure. It's pretty hard to reach, but it's what we should strive for. And the first step toward it is removing noise. So noise is a problem with some languages more than others. Java is guilty of that more than others, I think. So I will dive Java a little bit. But you know, there's noise in other languages as well. So noise works are things like name string. It's not better than name, because name is never going to be a floating point number. So maybe it's not that important to call it name string. But more subtle things like Hungarian notation. Nobody does that nowadays, right? Have you seen a project with Hungarian notation?
20 years ago.
Who doesn't know what Hungarian notation is? A few people. Okay, so it's simple. It's just annotating each variable with a prefix which indicates what type it is. So you would have things like ARR 8 number. It means it's an array of 8 numbers. I don't remember those. So this is noise, right? Also things like getters and setters. In JavaScript you have properties, right? But in Java it's pretty common to have getters and setters. They are usually noise. Why it's noise? Well, if you want to set something, just don't, because it's immutability and that's bad. If you want to get something, just call it by what it is. Not get name, but just name. How is person get name better than person name? It's not better, it's just less noise, or more noise in this case. Impulse suffixes, Java thing mostly, I prefixes, mostly .NET thing, you have I on all interfaces. And that's bad because it enables you to not think about names. In JavaScript, again, you don't have interfaces per se, unless in TypeScript, I think you do, right? You have interfaces in TypeScript?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So do you follow these conventions with people and I everywhere?
I.
You shouldn't. If you do that, it just says, I don't want to think about this meme. I have interface and one implementation. It's always going to be one forever and ever. Yes, well, I don't know if that's the case. Okay, so if we remove noise, what happens? In this code example, imagine this JavaScript. I didn't rewrite it in Java. In JavaScript, so in Java, imagine this JavaScript. So in this code you have red things marked as noise, which just can be removed without losing any information. And the blue things are marked as repetitive things. So you can tell them once, you have to mention them once, but you don't have to repeat them everywhere. Okay, so you have to mention it. It's something about the operations, that's it, something about balance, but you don't have to repeat balance everywhere. So what's happening here is we're checking whether after deducting a certain amount from an account, its balance is still going to be positive or it's going to be negative. So if I'm allowed to deduce this amount, debit, okay. Well, is there any shorter way to say the same thing? Of course there is. And I'm going to show you after this commercial break. So, it's Vitas Lukauskas, everyone knows him, and I love this quote. He said that too much time spent in ID teaches us bad habit that we stop reading what we write. And I think it's absolutely the case, especially which author affect the famous by a few keystrokes. So we stop looking at code as something which tells a story, and we look at more like, you know, something which is a malleable substance which allows us to hack things quickly to get what we want to do. But we don't look at it as a storyteller. And if we did look at it as a storyteller, then our code would look like this. What we're saying in the same piece of code is the balance after debit of 50 euro is negative. So the line below is exactly the same thing as the thing above, only minus noise and minus repetition. And having, you know, classes and objects and even functions, if you're a functional guy, allows us to do things like that, which are very, very expressive, and you should strive for code which tells a story and not code which just mechanical things to do, you know, a list of things to do. It doesn't tell a story. Okay, now let's move on to abstractions. Abstractions should answer a question, why do they exist?
This way of restructuring, it doesn't only change the naming, it also changes the structure, the responsibilities of stuff. So,
well, sure.
No, because we have balance service, which is external service, and if you have some request type, so.
Well, you assume it's an external service, but I assume it's just, you know, a thing which calculates balance. It's called a service because in Java, when you have business logic, you would call it a service, right?
But, so. Maybe it was agreed that services do the job and objects are just objects.
Okay, now you are moving towards a naming domain model, and I'm moving towards the main model.
So we should move to the main model?
Well, not necessarily, but the main model is more expressive in terms of how it tells a story about what the code does. So domain, like true domain model allows you to do things like that and be more concise, more expressive, and less mechanical. Just, I like it. I like it quite a lot. Okay, so why do you exist? Why is the domain question you should ask when you see an abstraction? Suppose in Java you have an interface called like that, object processing service. I didn't make it up. I wouldn't have made it up in my wildest dreams. I actually saw it in a real project I worked for. I left that company since then, so I won't mention. Yeah, and it was, I saw it. I thought about it a little bit. And I had no idea why it exists. It encapsulates everything wrong about naming, especially in OOP. So it has object missing, which is always important to tell your consumers that you're dealing with objects. Right? And it's a service, which usually doesn't mean anything. And what it does, it just processes objects. So what essentially it's saying, I'm a thing which is doing a thing with things. when you see that, you don't have a choice but just, you know, look inside. And it doesn't help you much. It actually had an implementation which was called Object Processing Service Import. I still have no idea what it does. I couldn't bother. Right, of course you can fix that by writing commands. Okay, so you can write, because I created this abstraction and what other stupid developers have no idea what it does. So I'm tired of answering questions, so I'm going to comment. This is the way you are supposed to use this abstraction. So commands are in their own right often a code smell. If you have to write commands, it may be because there's actually a business reason behind this particular abstraction. This reason cannot be expressed in code, but more often than not, it means that you did not bother to create a good enough abstraction which speaks for itself. Right? So if your abstractions don't speak for themselves, you write commands, and commands are a code smell. Refactor instead. Yeah. The point is, abstraction should not be abstract, so that's the thing I learned a long time ago. This is like an abstract abstraction, something like, I don't know, well, I don't know because I don't know what it's supposed to do. the name doesn't help me in a way. Can names be too concrete? Because okay, so we saw that names can be too abstract. Can they be too concrete? For example, it's a method. You can see immediately that it's a method in C sharp, right? It doesn't really matter. Or it could be, I don't know, Visual Basic. And it's saturating to zero when no orders appear for product. It's very concrete when you think about it, right? So it specifically tells what it does. But is it a good name? No, we are on the other side of the spectrum. Can it be too specific? Yeah, essentially that's the problem. You are so specific, you are putting implementation details into the name of the abstraction. So, for example, do I have to know that I have to saturate into zero? Okay. Can it change to something else, not zero? Do I have to know that it's in the last year? Could it change in the future to be in the last 6 months or so? Of course it could. So what I'm saying actually, I'm resetting the rating if there are no recent orders. Okay, so I'm changing the vocabulary to mean something like that. Reset outdated rating. Okay. What outdated means can change in the future. What reset means can change in the future. But that would not change my abstraction name. So now I have struck a balance between concreteness and abstractness, and that's a good name. Point is, you should always find the right level of abstraction. There are many levels. Every abstraction created would be very abstract, like object, all the way down to very concrete, like active directory authentication, and anything in between. So it always depends on the context of your consumers. Just going to consider that abstraction may need to know that you're talking about LDAP, or it may not care. So just call it authentication, for example. Okay, this does not matter if you don't have interfaces. We all know single responsibility principle. A class should have only one reason to change, right? If you can think of two reasons why some module or class may change, probably you should split it into two things. And if you can't think of a good name, there are two cases. Either it has more than one responsibility, right? Then you split it and you immediately know what the right name is for each of the parts. Or it may have no clear responsibilities at all, like object processing service. If it doesn't have clear responsibilities, you will have a hard time thinking of a name for it. That's just natural. Okay. Now this beast. It's pretty terrifying, but I like it so much, I'm going to put it in all of my talks from now on. Once who saw my talk previously know what it is, so shh. Those who don't, any ideas what this is? Any German-speaking audience members?
So it's some kind of thing in the shape of...
It's hard to tell, right? It's hard to think a name for it. It's kind of
I think it's one of our politicians.
Yeah, but it's a pig, but it also, you can milk it, but it also lays eggs, and it also has fur like a sheep. And it's from German folklore. It's called like that. Which literally means egg-laying wool milk pig. It's a thing. And Germans way back then understood the problem of bad naming and mixed responsibilities. So when you have mixed responsibilities, we end up with names like that. Of course, we are developers and we know how to fix it, right? How do we fix it? Well, we call it farm service. Because now we don't have a problem with farm names. Farm service can encapsulate any kind of animal-related behavior. So we can continue dumping behavior onto this abstraction forever and ever, and it will still be farm service, right? So problem solved. Yeah, service, by the way, happens to be a whistle word. A whistle word is something which is very abstract, very, what's the word here? It's very, I don't know, abstract, let's say it's abstract. So it allows you to name things without really thinking about them. A Wikipedia article on whistle words describe them as follows. So it's they create an impression that something specific and meaningful has been said, or well, in fact, only vague or ambiguous claim has been made. So that's vague and ambiguous are the keywords here. So politicians do things like, you know, we are going to solve a lot of problems next year, which doesn't mean anything, but it sounds great. Especially Donald Trump. Yeah, whistle words in object-oriented programming are there for you to observe and take a note. Well, I didn't use all of them, but I have seen all of them in action. It could be a service, could be a manager, a handler, or a processor. Utils and helper classes are always reliable. For data transfer, we have data, details, info, item, details, and all this reliable object. Then you can make something be a custom thing, or a default thing, or an abstract thing, or a base thing, or a simple or smart thing. I once saw in Spring Framework there are abstractions called message listener, I think. And one of them is a default message listener, and the other one is a simple message listener. I could never put my head around like which one should I use, the simple one or the default one. Mm-hmm. Right. So the problem, of course, is that you can replace any of these with you know, whatever. It will still reveal the same kind of intent. Okay. So they don't reveal intent. Why would I use the DTO instead of data, or info instead of details? What's the difference between them? There is no difference, because the name does not imply any meaning, any semantics. So when you have code like that, it leads to bad choices, and bad choices lead to bad design, which leads to more bad naming, and you are in a vicious cycle. But you can turn the cycle upside down, and you can start fixing it from any of the points. So, for example, you can fix bad design, and it will lead to better naming, which will lead to better choices, which will allow you to simplify the design even more, which will allow you to think of better names, and so you are now in the virtuous cycle. So a code can start at any point if you want to refactor you know, a pathetic piece of code well. It's best to start, I think, at names, because it's the easiest part. So just by thinking of a better name for an abstraction, a class, a method, a function, you immediately enable somebody else to get this code to make a better judgment about how this abstraction should be used and whether it should be, you know, split or removed at all. And once they make those choices, they simplify the design, and then the wheel turns again. So you can make better naming, better choices, and better design. So start with names, and you will be better off. Some things coming from OOP. I don't know if it's very popular in JavaScript to call things doers, you know, like message sender, object processor, things like that. But in some popular server-side programming languages, pretty popular. And it's not immediately a bad thing. Okay? So when you have doer classes, they follow always the same pattern. Something, something, doer, do something, something. It's an object-oriented, you know, plague. You can always think of that abstractions. For example, who is the party responsible for sending messages? Well, it could be an SMS channel or an SMS gateway thing. So you can do better. But sometimes all you need is a function, really. So when you have a doer class, just have a function. If you have a class called something doer with one method called do something, just do something. Okay, you don't have, don't need a container for a function always. Not really. In JavaScript, you have free functions. them don't feel the need to put everything inside classes, as I'm sure you don't. Okay, and the last piece I want to talk about is domain modeling. So domain-driven design, I like to put this book everywhere at the time. It's great, read it. It's not an easy read, but it's worth it. Who has read this book? Okay. Four, five. I made it till the last chapter and then I just turned out. I couldn't bear it anymore. But yeah, it's a hard read, but it's really packed, you know, with advice on good design. So in this book, Eric Evans advises to describe your business scenarios out loud, and it will help you create a better model. So how it works is just, you know, it's pretty easy. Just say it out loud. Which is a better design? Like when user changes a username, we set username and user data and save it by user DAO. That's what's in the code, but it doesn't sound right somehow. It sounds ugly and awkward. How about when user changes username, we change username in user repository? Little better, maybe. How about when user changes username, we store username changed event to event queue? Maybe. And you iterate, and you find what sounds like most like English language you will speak. And when you find that, you put it to code. So if it sounds good, it's probably better as a design artifact. Because at the end of the day, again, code should tell a story. It will not tell a story if it's very mechanical. I guess there's nobody cares about that. Okay. Use ubiquitous language. Again, the book talks about ubiquitous language again and again and again. It's one of the most important concepts in domain-driven design. So use the same language as you speak with customers, analysts, testers, and developers, and use the same language in your code. That way, you will create less confusion about which abstractions mean which in the business language.
The issue here is that this change typically. The problem is not that people are not thinking about how to name it, but that they do not really know when they write the code. Or it changes.
Well, is it they don't know because the analyst keeps changing their mind? Or is it they don't know because they don't talk to business people and they don't know the business processes? Because most of the time, the business process terminology is pretty set in stone. Like, if you are working in an industry which is quite old, you know, like, I don't know, shipping, banking, whatever, it usually has a well-defined vocabulary. You just have to know it. And to know it, you have to talk to, well, the main experts. It could be the customer, it could be some good analyst which has been working in the domain for a long time. It won't be the developer, not ever. Developer is never the main expert. But you know, it shouldn't change. So business language does not change. Usually what changes is our understanding of the language. And if you are allowed to change the domain model so long as you make it simpler, you make it a better, more natural fit for the business problem. But the business problem is always there, and it's usually well stated. The problem could be communication between business guys and developers. So make this communication tighter, so it's not easy. It's not easy, you have to really have a tight communication. But when you get there, and the code becomes a pretty natural expression of the business problem. So it becomes easier to change. A few more advice. You should always try to make implicit concepts and explain from the book. Like account operation service, when you see things like that, okay, implicitly it implies something that is more concrete because it's too abstract. So if you look inside of it, you find that what it does, it logs all premises and debits. So the first step of action is to write what it does into the name. So if it logs credits and debits, just call it credit and debit log. Okay, that's always an improvement over an abstract work. But then you can take the next step and search for a business artifact or a business abstraction which does what this thing does. So what is a business term for something which is a credit embedded law? Is there such a business term? If it's a financial application, for example.
Yeah, sure.
Just a ledger. So just call it ledger. And now you have made an implicit concept. It was hiding there in this name somewhere, but it wasn't made explicit. Now we made it explicit and have a better design. Okay? For that, I'm no expert in financial terminology, so I usually use thesaurus, I use Investopedia, I search for terms to put in my code. And that's all right. If you can't talk to the name experts every day, you can do that as well. Yeah. In order to control the spirit, you must know its true name. That's what I was talking about. This makes names intention revealing. Okay. Does this name reveal intention? I'm almost done. Bear with me. Well, intention revealing, what does it mean? It means you know when to call it, and if you have to change something, you know where to find the place you have to change. So that means it's intention revealing. Get result does not have any of these two qualities, but if you look at its implementation, you find that what it does, it sums up all debits and credits. That's what it does. So your first action is to just put all of the implementation into the name. And that's an improvement, as before. The next step, of course, is find a better name for it. So what do we call the sum of debits and credits?
Balance,
sure. So we calculate balance. And now we have revealed intention. It was abstract and clear before. Now we know two things. We know if we need to change balance calculation algorithm, that's the method to go to. And the next thing, what's the next thing? Yeah, I don't know. That's it. That's all we get. Okay, so to recap, your code should tell a story. Try to read it out loud. If it sounds good, it's probably right. If it sounds awkward, try to refactor. Reduce noise. Don't use weird prefixes and suffixes, and setters and getters and things like that. Always try to reveal intention. Always ask yourself the question, why does this abstraction exist? If you can't answer it easily, refactor. Avoid whistle words, or things like service manager, data, DTO, and so on. Always try to use the language that the domain experts use. And finally, which I didn't talk enough about, the way to get to a well-named code structure is to work incrementally. So always, you won't get it right the first time, you won't get it right the second time. For each abstraction, you will probably rename it a few times before you get it right. That's okay. That's how you make improvements. So don't be afraid to refactor as much as possible. For that, you will need a good test suite, of course, but I guess that's a given nowadays. Some of the advice I have read and seen myself. I guess I'm done. I'm open for questions. 10 minutes or so.
Yeah. You had like a list of weasel words, right?
Yeah, I love
items. Yeah. There is no word factory. is it because it didn't fit, or?
Well, that's the main reason. Actually, the same guy who I mentioned, the German guy who is a PhD in psychology and computer science, he also wrote another article which was in German journal, and I definitely wanted to read it. That bad that I actually read in German, and not that with a German, but I read it in original German. It was quite long, but I'm great at it. So what it talked about is actual weasel words and how they affect the deterioration of code design in the long run. And so he had a collection of about, 100 maybe weasel words. So this is just peanuts, you know. So even things like repository can be considered a weasel word because it doesn't reveal enough semantics, enough intent about the code in use, or service, of course. Or, yeah, factory, a whole category is design patterns. So if you name your classes after design patterns they implement, you essentially are using weasel words to describe what you do. So if something is customer factory, what does that tell you? Well, it creates customer objects, but that's too mechanical. Maybe there's some underlying business term for what it does. Maybe a customer factory is, you know, a recruitment process, or I don't know, onboarding, so-called onboarding, if that's what it represents in the other name. So in that sense, every time you use a word to label your class, just because I don't want to think of what it actually represents, is a weasel word, and it may include design patterns as well. But not necessarily. If you're working on a mechanical level, so if a consumer of your code is a developer, and your domain problem is actually a developer problem, like if you're building Spring Framework, okay, so your consumers are developers, well, maybe your domain is actually factories and proxies and things like that. And you make it for developers easier to understand what this piece of code does and they should use it. But it's always context dependent.
Yes. For example, this user words as DTO, sometimes you have account representation in many layers. And you just have to label it somehow, just to distinguish?
Only if you work in a static type language, you have this problem. If you work in a dynamic language, sure. I mean, you have a data structure and you're passing it along multiple layers, and it differs a little bit between the layers. So you have to think of a name for it in each layer, so that's a problem. Again, I would try to find the underlying cause for existence. So what is the intent behind this particular shape of the data structure? Like, if it's account data, well, maybe it's an account record. Okay, so maybe this account data actually represents a physical database record, so call it account record. If it's used in the view model, well, maybe it's, account snapshot or account view or something like that. There are ways to go around it. It's not always easy, I admit that. But still, try to be creative. You know? It's hard to be creative, especially with naming. But try, and I'm sure you will find better ways to do the same things. And when you reveal intent, it becomes easier for everyone to understand. If you just call it info, it's so arbitrary. You know? Why info? Why not details?
I have a question. Do you think that no-spacing things to avoid the inclusions is a good idea? Like you have accounts here, and if you put it into separate folder system.
Nowadays we have packages and namespaces and modules in JavaScript. So they already act like namespaces.
Yeah, but is it good or bad?
If you do it only to avoid name collisions, then I'd say it's bad because that's what other tools are for, tools like packages and modules and namespaces. If you only do it because you like to find classes by name, and you type in account, and now you have three accounts and don't know which to pick, maybe you're optimizing for the usage of a particular tool you use, but you're not optimizing for expressiveness of your domain language. So I don't know. Nowadays I don't have this problem. I used to have. Yeah. I used to get worked up about having two classes in the same way across all of my application, which was like 500 lines of code. But nowadays, I just, if it's an account, in this particular bounded context, which I didn't talk about, so if you have bounded different things, but you name the same, so it's okay. But it's a long topic.
Yeah. What is the recommendation for grouping things? These are names for single things, but if I want to group functionality dealing with accounts into something, or, you know, customers, you have a lot of stuff to do with customers, a lot of functions which deal with customers, I want to group. What about groups? How to name groups?
Yeah, every time you try to group something, you should follow the principle of cohesion and coupling. So you group things which are cohesive, which means they have a lot of interactions between each other, so group them together, and you make them separate from things which are loosely coupled. So if this group of things and this group of things don't have a lot of interactions between the two, you put them in separate packages or separate use cases. How to name that? It will become pretty natural. Because if these things all communicate with each other pretty intensely, then they will naturally be bound to some particular subdomain. Like it will be custom enrollment subdomain. You know, and they will all have something to do with enrolling a new customer. And they will implement like everything from presentation to data access, for example, in this instance. They would call it enrollment. I can't anything more specific than that. I can't do because I need a code example. Mm-hmm. But no, in coupling and cohesion are the two things you're looking for to group things together.
So if we call everything var, it will be good in this case.
Well, var in this case?
Var. Account var.
I account. Well. well, I didn't mean for all of these to be in the same package. Sure, the most natural name, I guess, would be accounts.
What if you have like a whole code base and you have like 100 objects named ending with service? Would you introduce another one without this name? Because like it breaks
yeah.
consistency.
That's a good one. Yeah. I always get this question.
Yeah.
Should you break consistency if only to introduce a small improvement to one part of the code? I used to be a little bit more strict about that. I used to say you should, because you should start small and then, you know, outgrow. But nowadays I know that it will probably imply more harm than good. And because if you work in a legacy system, there's already a lot of context that the developer needs to keep in their heads. And they usually use these labels as means of navigation inside the code. So if you break these patterns, you will make their lives even harder. So I would say no, but if you do have a legacy monolith, for example, and you are trying to evolve it, usually what you would do nowadays is to use like an application's triangular pattern to extract small bits out of it into small services and microservices. And within those new services,